infant school when I started, when I was 5 years old. And everybody went here, came through this gateway, and we went here from 5 till about 7. Then we went up into the lads, this is girls' school here, went round the front to the big lads, as they call it then, at 7 years old. And from 7 till 14, I was in that school round there. But this is where I started school. 7 years old, in what, 1931. And what they call the big lads, Mr. Barwell, head teacher. Very good and kind man, but sick, like I don't know, messing about then. And this is our playground. Many a game of football, cricket, what have you. Hail, rain, snow, and blow, we were turned out here for playtime. No school meals then. And this school probably had, what, 130 lads. No girls, the girls were around there. And there was one cold water tap which was in that lobby come hall here. And one cold coke stove in the middle of the big room. And that was the only heating, and the sanitary facilities, as you call them, were in that corner over there, just the urinals and WCs. And this is where we spent our learning years.
What is the name of the school, George?
St Silas School. We used to call it St Silas Academy for Young Gentlemen, Edward Street. And the school uniform, as such, was a cap. Everybody wore a cap. But I mean, if you had a cap, a new cap, the first thing that the bully did, the school cock, as we call him, he'd grab it off you, bite the button off, and throw the cap over the wall and say, follow the cap. And the rest of it was a jersey with a woolen tie, usually. And all with a hole worn here. Everybody had a hole in the front and sleeves down here. And you only had got a handkerchief, and they say, see that girl up there? Tweed short trousers, winter and summer, no long trousers. You weren't put into long trousers till you were 14. That's what they call you, a britch then. I'm taking him to be britch, the mother used to say, and buy a pair of long trousers, but you were 13 or 14 then. And boots, nobody wore shoes, plenty of studs in them. I mean, well, they had to last you for years and years, and then they were passed down when they got too small for you, you're too big for them. And this is where we used to play football, cricket up at that top end there. We used to chalk some stumps up there, and there'd be 130 kids in this playground milling round. Very handy when it was snowing. And the gate was kept locked. There was usually one teacher who kept an eye on us, breaking fights up and what have you.
And all round here, George, what was
all
it?
All round here, there was a row of very old property here, back-to-back houses. There was a sweet shop there, and an archway across the road with a coal yard up it. And Haven and Lewis battery place was just opposite. I used to go all there with accumulators for my father's wireless. Swift and Goodison's, they were across the road there. On that corner there, when it says A to Z, that was where Mr. Hall, the school caretaker, lived. And unfortunately, one morning when we came, there was a very subdued air, and he'd collapsed and subsequently died here, Mr. Hall, who lived there.
Had he?
And most of the kids lived in these houses round here. I lived 100 yards away.
So there was real poverty?
Well, when you say poverty, we didn't think it was poverty. You know, I mean, people were hard up, but a lot of pride.
How happy?
There was no whining and this and that, like, they were hard up. I never heard anybody say we were hard up. They might have said they were skint, you know, but they never, you know, in a matter of pride, like, and a lot of kids, they hadn't even shoes there, but they got to school. St. Silas Church, now that was the church to the school which we went to, and usually we went probably twice a year, twice, it was Easter and Whitsuntide, and we all trooped from school. This was a Tanner Street, it was a narrow cobble street then, now it's Hanover Way, and as you can see it's a new cabin. And we used to go over there, and I think we had half a day off afterwards, and Eubank was the vicar then, the sporting parson. He trained a very good team of boxers. In fact, Johnny Cosper was under his wing. He subsequently became champion of England. And this church is still, well, we've cleaned it up recently, but when I was a kid, a few years ago, it was black, like all the buildings around here, were black with smoke.
And you were like that?
Well, I liked it better sometimes, you know, because I mean, there weren't donkey's years of character and grime and sweat went into making buildings like that. And sometimes they look a bit too fresh. They're like an old girl painted up, you know.
What about this, George? What? Viners.
Viners? Well, I came to Viners during the war, 1941. And it had suffered a bit of bomb damage, but nothing like this. And I worked here for a few years until 1948. And I left and I went out working. And I worked in various firms all over Sheffield, still die sinking and out working. And I came back probably 1957 and worked till it finished. In fact, I think I put the lights out here on Christmas Eve 3 years ago. And this is what it's come to. Once one of the biggest cutlery firms in Europe. This is the end of the road.
Very, very sad, George.
Yeah. Silas, in front of it. And this is the street I used to come down, Bramall Road, going on to Bramall Street. 30-odd years I walked down here every morning, getting in for 7:30. Used to be a newspaper shop on that corner, and Viners stood there. Big building, Viners, limited across the front of it. But now, it's an empty space. And as you can see, the church has been cleaned up. Looks quite attractive in this light, I suppose. But I always remember this as much as anything, black. And it's snowing round here. We seem to get more snow then than what we do now. And on a winter's morning, you can see this stuck up black against the snow. And Viners lit up behind it, like the Crystal Palace, because Viners were nearly all glass. Way in front of its time, actually, built in the 1930s, and all glass and concrete. And then little houses, terraced houses along Bramall Street, Poplar Pub. We used to go in there, the old Poplar. Walter Rags pub, and dozens of little pubs around there and shops, sandwich shops. You could nip out for a sandwich. If you nipped out now, you'd finish up in the Royal Hampshire. There's not much traffic flying around what used to be Clarence Street. So, well, I don't know whether it's the end of one year, it might be the beginning of another, but one thing about it, I suppose it is quiet around here, but so is a graveyard. Some of the buildings are still there. They're obviously, a lot have gone, but I remember the ones which have gone. And these little shops here on the right, they're being converted now, but up to a few years ago, there was a fruit shop, pastry shop and a tripe shop. And as kids, we used to go to the tripe shop, apples of tripe bits. You get about half a pound of tripe cut up into pieces, salt and vinegar and pepper on them. And my God, what a feast for the halfpenny. And of course you get cow heels, cow's udder. Cow's udder, you never see cow's udder now. Hot and steaming it was, lovely. And we used to come down here, London Road, a bit farther down, Lansdowne Picture Palace, but up here, the coffee house as we call it, Billion Saloon, used to play Skittles a lot there, not seen that play now. And I think that's where the origin of the saying came from, don't try the coffee house tricks here, old lad. You know, meaning anybody trying a bit of sharp practice. And I think that's where I let the play snooker there. Pre-war, one of the places anyway, because a lot of billiard halls, snooker places and all that, billiards was played quite a lot. In fact, snooker wasn't considered quite the thing. Billiards was the gentleman's game. But all sorts of games were played on the tables. I said it was snooker, skittles, golf, bagatelle. And London Road, like all the streets in Sheffield, was alive with people. I mean, you don't see the amount of people now on foot anyway. I mean, you'll get 30 or 40 cars in the street. There'll only perhaps be 30 or 40 people. But in the old days, as I say, you could walk across the street. You weren't shepherding into the cattle pens like you are now, underpasses and all that, and you could stand in the middle of the road. You know a tram was going to keep on its track, not going to swerve round, and the amount of car traffic and all that. Adam lads, you never see Adam lads in Sheffield streets here. I don't know whether we regarded them so much as characters, because they always seem to be there. Most of them had the regular neighbourhoods, runs or what have you. I mean, like in the billiard saloon there, a couple of characters there. There was Big Herbert and Little Herbert. Big Herbert used to do a bit of porting in the market, as did Little Herbert. Little Herbert was I should call him a dwarf, really. And when the circuses came to town, he'd get a job tumbling with the clowns, knockabout comedian and what have you. But for all that, he's a damn good snooker player. He could play with the rest off the edge of the table as good as anybody. Big Herbert was a good one, but there's also a one-arm snooker player used to go in there. And he used to play, get the brush he used to brush the table with and run his cue through it. And you might laugh at that, but by God, it'd give most of us three black start. I mean, we were kids, we thought we could play snooker and all this and that. And they'd let us win a game or two playing for the table, and they said, right, you're playing for the tanner. Well, the tanner was the price of a pint of beer. My God, you wouldn't see which way they went for the tanner. I don't think Steve Davis had much of a look in them fellas. And, as I say, all the little shops, which weren't long gone now, the pubs are still there, the old tramway, Barrel, and the old Crown there, Furniture Place, that's still there. But these roofs have all been done up, some of the chimneys have gone and all that. Well, this is a lower concrete garage or something now, but then it was a fish and chip shop. I mean, quite a lot of fish and chip shops. Every street corner nearly had one. And as I say, no matter what time, really, of the day, the streets were a lot of people in them. And I don't know, a general air of life. All the little back streets were crowded with tatters, houses, banners, also smoke coming out of the chimneys. I've got that. I didn't really come round here. As I say, most of these characters had their particular runs and areas. The Duke of Darnell was a town man. He was a man about town with his bowler hat and his yellow gloves in his hand. Buttonhole, usually a light grey suit, spats. And he'd see A young lady wanting to cross the road, he walked straight in the middle of the road, hold his hand up, stop the traffic. And my God, they did stop for him too.
Fresh and tender kiss, add one stolen night of bliss. One girl, one boy, some grief, some joy, memories are made of this. Don't forget a small lonely. Fall in lightly with a dream,
as they call it. And another thing too about the adverts. There were adverts all over the walls. In fact, prices were so static that they could afford to paint the prices on walls. There's one not far from where I live. Ireland malt whiskey, 3 shillings and 7 pence a bottle. Guinness, half a crown a dozen bottles. And of course there was no television then, and the best way of advertising was posters or signs painted on walls, like a big one here, Ward's Fine Malt Ales, Tramway Hotel would be painted on. All these are going to be adverts. Orvis bread, that was, you still see a few of those Orvis breads knocking about. And lot of fancy sign writing on all these little shops. So all in all, you know, there's quite a lot of colour in the streets, even though some days the smoke was that bad you could hardly see 100 yards on it.
Well, I call this picture an outworker's yard. Years ago, in fact there's still a few left, but years ago there were hundreds of these outworkers. An outworker's a bloke who worked for himself. He wasn't a little mester. A little mester was a fellow who employed people, but an outworker, he usually worked on his own, perhaps with a lad, and he outworked for, well, anybody but the big firms. And yards like this, the old cobble yard there, you can see the grate. The yard was usually dipped into the grate so everything could run into it. And you get all these workshops here. And I remember this particular one, they had to put the fire escape down. This is a fire escape here. See, all these rooms were, you know, pretty high up, down stone staircases or rickety wooden staircases. And every place had some sort of a fire. Some had hearths in for forging. But everyone had a fire in, either for heating or cooking or whatever they wanted to do with it. And, of course, it could be a big fire hazard. Now, all these shops would be occupied by dozens of people. In a yard like this, they could easily be 50 or 60 people working. And of course the rents were cheap, the overheads were low, and they'd turn a damn good product out. This is where Sheffield made its name, with these little fellas working on the... There was a Cocker and Crossland and Rawson Brothers. In, as I say, 1930s, there were hundreds of little cutlers, or to do with the cutlery and steel trades, and buffer lasses. A chap used to have a team of buffers, and they'd be buffing spoon and fork or Holloway or something like that. And this fella here, he was a silversmith. Well, he'd just got a bench, rigged his bench up and all that, and he didn't need much tattle really, apart from the tools. Well, one of the many advantages really is that you've got a big industrial town with the amenities of libraries and cinemas and what have you, transport. But yet, right up to the outskirts, still, the moorland comes and farmland. Now this is an old favourite of mine, Peat Farm, bottom of Roper Hill. This is Brown Hills Lane, going along there. Billy Mills, an old pal of mine, he's farmer here. And his father was before him, just across the road. And old Bill, we often have a chat. I go up and say to him, "How you going, Bill?" "Oh," he says, "Oh, I'm all right." He says, "I'm not strong enough to be badly, so I've got to be all right." And they're very independent, these fellas. They're like counterpart of the Sheffield cutlery or steel outworker. They've they work for themselves, they don't employ anybody, perhaps their wife helps them or family, and they help other farmers in harvest time or what have you. Most of it now is laid out for barley and cattle, really. But these buildings, they probably date back 200, 250 years, and still as good as ever. The old roofs might sag a bit, but they'll stand up for another few hundred years. Another little lane here, Cottage Lane, quite near where I live, call it the White House, this. And this long building here, the area is known as Whiteley Wood Green, but this is one of the few surviving crook barns, which God knows how old that'll be, hundreds of years old, and built on crooks, which were actually tree trunks. And it's still a little red post box, which they used to have in the country. And blokes in those days go round on a bike or on foot, and well, I don't know what the round was, but a good few miles, and they'd do it in hail, rain, snow, or blow, as they say. And he's the first post out. Nobody's been on the lane before him, obviously. And he'll know he's had a day out.
Lane, this.
At the end of it. And it's aptly named Quiet Lane. He was, although it's, what, I don't know, 3 miles, 4 miles from the city centre, you're in another world, absolute open country all the way out. And these are known as car houses, car houses and car cottages. And this was the old blacksmith's shop. But, I mean, in the old days, plenty of farms around there, and obviously they're all using horses, and used to bring them here, up this lane here, to be shod. There's quite a big yard here. And this goes out now up onto Mayfield Road. You get higher up, just beyond that tree line there, there's the open moorland. And yet, as I say, within 4 or 5 miles of Sheffield. What I like on days like this, I like being in town. I've spent a lot of time in town. I was born and bred in town. But how lucky we are to be able to get out from the outworkers' yard, or whatever you might call it, the smoke and grime of Sheffield, out here, even on a day like this. This is Addison Lane, Bowl Hill Farm. And the chap came to Bowl Hill and built this farm probably, I don't know, in the 1600s, a man called Marsden. And most of the families in Mayfield Valley, obviously the Marsdens, Foxes, Brumheads, Woodhouse, all came from him. And fascinates me to think that even after 250, 300 years, the old farm's still there, hardly altered really, as the lane. There's nothing on it except an odd farm even today. Fulwood Hall, just down here, and the outskirts of Sheffield coming along there. But you can be miles and, well, you think you're miles and miles away from any city, never mind the biggest, from the old snow scenes, as you can see. This is Nursery Street, the wicker main thoroughfare of Sheffield to the steelworks. Well, Nursery Street, a lot of steelworks used to be on the left-hand side. The pub's still there, the Hare and Hounds. In fact, this bloke and his mate are just deciding whether to go in or not. The trams ran along here. Trinity Church here, and this building here was a flour mill. Building's still there, and the miller's house, that's where the miller lived here, and a couple of small firms here, and then the old coroner's court of Sheffield with the mortuary at the back. Of course, this is where all the inquests were held, and autopsies and what have you. Wicker Lane, curling round to the wicker. Hobson's make beer engines, beer pumps and what have you. And there was always a bobby on duty at the door. And the old solicitors, probably a lady, his husband died or something like that, and the family solicitor with her. And this bloke, he's obviously mourning somebody. He's perhaps going in there for a bit of cheer before he gives evidence. And there again, Nursery Street was full of people, because even in streets like this, round the back, there were terraced houses and all sorts of little shops, pubs and what have you. So there again, the streets, this is rather a quiet day, probably beginning of the day, 9 or 10 o'clock in the morning. But say dinner time, when the work turned out for the dinner, they'd be full of people, and at half past five, it'd be like a football match along here. My father, that's in Sheffield, Michael Road in Sheffield, and my grandfather, George Barringer, had a pickle business in Queen's Street, quite a prosperous one, and it was taken over by my mother at the death of him and her brothers in the late 1920s, and then she married my father. And something went wrong with the business, it collapsed or what have you, for whatever reasons in those days. And, my father was out of work, obviously, and there was no dough. So he started making pickles in the back kitchen at home. And he, my mother and my brother and I, used to spend night after night skinning onions, peeling onions, helping to bottle them, and take them out in a suitcase next day. Anyway, after a bit of doing this, there's a pub, the Royal Oak, bottom of Cemetery Road, and the landlord, a pal of my father, like a lot of landlords were, and he had a back room at the pub. So he let my father have this, sort of rent-free, and he made pickles there and take them out next day. And after a bit, business was prospering to the extent, he said, we'd better get a van for you. And he got an old Morris Bullnose van. And this landlord took my father around the lump, as they call it, a few times, driving lessons, and there you are, you're on the road. And just after that, this would be 1931 or 2, I was very ill with pneumonia. I was in Ledgewood Hospital for about 6 months, and when I came out, I didn't go to school for another year. And my father used to take me all over Sheffield delivering pickles. And I think that's when I first got to know Sheffield. All the back streets, the little shops, plenty of pubs. I used to wait outside. If he fancied a drink, he'd bring me a bottle of lemonade out. And that year, I think I still remember it, even though it's 50-odd years ago. And when I see some of the streets, what they've done to them now, and like they used to be, well, it does upset me a bit. But at least I've got the memories of them, and I'm still young enough to be able to paint
this. Your colour is very good. Tell me, have you had a holiday in Tenerife?
No, in fact, I've had less holidays since I've been painting full time than ever I had. But I get out a lot, you know. And well, the thing, you know, you've got to look after yourself. I eat plenty of parking, like, and get a few gold labels down me. And in spring, I have 2 or 3 coats of varnish, and I look as good as ever for about a year, you know. It's weatherproofing and all that, because, you know, I've got to get out in all sorts of weather to do these paintings.
And you walk to work?
I walk to work, aye. It's only about 4 miles, and I walk back. And, you know, I never thought cars would catch on. I mean, that's why I never had one. But apart from that, it's a very pleasant walk. And if you get up early enough, I usually get up about 5:30, and set off, say, I don't know, 6, 6:15 or so, and sometimes it takes me an hour and a half to get to work, and I could do it in 3/4 of an hour. But there again, all the time I'm walking down, I'm getting ideas, and sometimes I'll make all sorts of detours, and people will say, when I get home, where's your husband working? I saw him coming down Granville Road this morning. I thought he worked in town. See, every kid, as soon as it's able to hold a piece of chalk and a pencil or something like that, will write or scribble or draw. And everybody does that till they're 13 or 14 years old, and then they figure all about it. And that's what I did. You know, apart from the odd doodle, I mean, I started work at 14. I mean, when he got home, he didn't feel much like painting and drawing. He wanted to get out. But I think it was a little bit better than that.
Just sticking your mind. We know about Duke Cadano. And is there any more that...
Well, there were the well-known ones, like you say, like Duke Cadano and Long Sammy and Russian Edna, Nellie Peel and all that. But the Backstreets had the character as well. I mean, one in particular lived near me, next street to me, actually. And it was a bike repairer called Harry Metcalf. And anybody had any trouble with a bike, a bottle wheel, a spokes missing, anything like that, you say, oh, take it to Harry Metcalf. And Harry Metcalf, actually, was a very, very small man. He'd only be about 3 feet tall. In fact, his kids, we were as tall as he was. And he was crippled. But that didn't stop him mending bikes. Anything wrong with a bike, he put it right, Harry Metcalf. And in a cloth cap on, spectacles, little bib and brace overalls on. And he built himself in the 1930s, late 20s and 30s, a miniature motorbike, perfect in every detail, not a moped, an actual motorbike. And it was driven by a flywheel. He used to rear the back wheel up, spin the back wheel round, and spin the flywheel round to get it going. And you see him buzzing all over Sheffield. And also, he was a Salvationist there. And he played, I think it was a French horn or tuba. And the damn thing was as big as he was. And he'd be sitting there, you see him sometimes in the back of the shop, practicing on this tuba. But as I say, I've very fond memories of these people in the back streets. As I say, apart from the town characters, being me bonnet for a long time. But I was 48 years old and used to go out for a drink every night with a wife and all that. And I don't know whether the pubs were starting to alter or what then, but I know they went over from pumps in my local to beer meters. And I think that was, to my mind, I thought, well, I don't know. I could do with some interest. And I thought, well, I'll have a go at painting and drawing. And I got myself a sketchbook and a pencil. And I think the first thing I started to do was I walked out to the Surprise near Addisage, Surprise View, and tried to draw that in a 10x7 sketchbook. And I still realised, like, it was a bit beyond me. But from then, I never stopped drawing or painting. And I would think in the, 13 years or so I've been painting since, I must have painted literally thousands of paintings. I've burnt, by my own rejection, hundreds of them. And I was doing this and getting a lot of pleasure out of it. And the more I did, the more I wanted to do. In fact, every night, winter and summer, I'd do at least 2 or 3 hours every night and all weekends. And I bought all my materials from Hibbert Brothers, and I've been painting probably 6, 7 years or something like that. And Frieda, Miss Hibbert, she said to me, what do you do with your paintings? Well, I said, I don't really know. I said, I burn a lot of them as far as I'm good. Well, I said, bring some into the shop. And I took some in, they were oil paintings. And they sold them. And I thought, well, you know, good luck. And this gradually went on until I was still working. And I was selling these, or Hibbert were selling them part-time, until I was made redundant. Of all days, Christmas Eve, when the firm was liquidated, we got our redundancy notice and said, dear sir, your employment with the above company will terminate on Christmas Eve. So, anyway, to me it was a big relief in a lot of ways, because I'd done 44 years in factories, and I thought, well, that's enough for anybody. And I'll have a go at painting full time. And which it has, you know, it's no use me saying I wish it had happened 20 or 30 years ago. It couldn't have done, because I wasn't painting then. And I don't think I could have painted then, like I can now. Oh, it's worked out very well for me. As I say, I was born in Sheffield, down at the bottom of the moor, actually, corner of Clarence Street and Marshall Road. And our playground was a big part of Sheffield there. Because as kids we used to roam round, there wasn't the traffic to worry about. We played football in the streets and marbles, all sorts of things. And we used to run up and down the moor. And as I got older, you know, that the moor used to be a promenade. It wasn't choked up with brick tram cars and bandstands and the pile of bricks at the bottom now. It was a well-known thoroughfare into and out of Sheffield. And it was, as I say, a regular promenade for Sheffield, is to walk up one side and walk down the other. And I've always loved the moor as it was, and I can still remember every shop on it. A lot of it was badly blitzed in 1940. But the other part, which I do like, is still the city centre, the old town hall, not the new egg crate. All the old buildings like the Yorkshire Penny Bank, H.L. Brown's, they weren't there pre-war, but the buildings were there. Wilson Peck's on the corner, Timpson's, well, it used to be a Lion's Coffee House, and Barker's Pool, which is there again being altered, I mean, but the old cinema house used to be there, the Regent, the City Hall's still there, but the Albert on the corner, pub, well, you know, they used to have dances every, well, a couple of nights a week there, like the Cutler's Hall, and that area of town I still love, especially evening time, when the paper sellers, they still shout them, still shout the final, and early morning, I like the town. Carry on, obviously, as long as I can hold a brush. I mean, I suppose that's the advantage of being a painter, that you can do it almost anywhere, painting. You can do it at home, you can do it in a studio and whatnot. And people say, well, to me, aren't you limited by what you can paint in Sheffield? But I would think that there's still, you know, I hope to see the ton out, like, and it'd be enough to keep me going, I think, the next 39 years.
George Cunningham, artist, thank you very much indeed.
Hibbert's shop. Well, it would be, I don't know, I suppose the painting's around about 1933. And at that time, I used to look in their windows, never dreaming that one day I'd have an exhibition there. And a lot of it is just the same as it always was. The building here is just the same, bank, brown bear. Hayes has gone, but it's a Ruskin gallery now. Victoria Hall's here, still there. Hudson's Cafe, you get a high tea, what is it, one and six. 1 and 6 for the high tea, pot of tea, a tanner. And this is the old city architect's building there. Now, the steamer here used to deliver. I remember as a kid, we used to watch these things chugging about. They had a driver and a stoker, firing coal in. All this went to this old Sheffield grayness, as you might call it, but still a lot of colour in it. Every little house had a chimney belching smoke out. All the shops were heated by coal, cooked by coal. And on a day like this, when it had snowed, you used to get that lovely slushy look about pavement and people. There were more people in the streets, because obviously there were less cars. And people had walk about in the middle of the street. In fact, they'd have a conversation there. And just stand on one side like. And I always like this little corner. This is where the Halifax Building Society is. Stonework's still as good as new. In fact, it looks better now than it did then, because all these buildings were black with smoke. They've been cleaned up. When I say better, I don't know. The old way sometimes they had a lot more character. You know, I mean, today they've cleaned up and they look a bit concretey. Whereas the old style, you know, it looked as though they'd been carved out of coal. They were that black, some of them. And as you went down Norfolk Street here, you could go straight down Norfolk Street into Fitzalan Square. But now, of course, it's cut off at this motorway. And Hay and Sons, that was the watering place for the old true-blooded professional drinkers. You always got a bigger measure than Hay's. Red Rover whiskey was their brand whiskey, and they used to have their whiskey in a fifth of a gill. Not much, about a penny more than the normal measure, but a fifth of a gill was a good whiskey. And in there was the old barrels and whatnot. And I remember, don't seem all that long ago to me, that they had three barmen there in white aprons, white collars, immaculate. And the total service between them was somewhere around about 150 years to A's, and you know, they could serve very quickly, efficiently, and with a lot of courtesy, which I'm afraid it's a bit lacking these days, isn't it, when you go in the pub. But anyway, having said that, coming back up here, this is Mama's pizza parlour now, used to be a news agent, and Hibbers hadn't altered at all. And when I look in there now, today even, I've been down there today, it's just as it was in, well, 1930, that I remember it, 30-odd. Anyway, I think we've had about enough of that one. We'll go on to another town scene, another popular one here. Now this is old Church Street. Then again, this is hardly altered. Cutler's Hall still there, Midland Bank, Stonehouse, these shops here. That's Bartley's Bank now, used to be Martin's. These buildings here, the Gladstone buildings, well, they refurbished them a year or two back and they just about got them finished and they burnt down again. So they had to build them up again. So that's like three guzz they've had at that. The original, one that were burnt down, and this new one. Now here, this pavement was raised up from the level of Church Street, framed by big iron railings which were taken down during the war. They burnt them off. Supposedly be for the war effort. I mean, they might have been fired anywhere. So they're give you food for thought about all these railings. There were railings around every little terraced house in Sheffield, well, all over the country, but particularly I think in Sheffield, with it being known for cast iron and iron founding, they must have melted, or they took down thousands of tons of railings just to throw somebody else across the water like. But anyway, this is the cathedral forecourt now, but it used to be shrouded with dark yew trees. The entrance went in there, and this was the old cab rank, the taxi rank. Now, Cutler's up to, not very, well, it seems to me anyway, not very long ago, used to have a dance, couple of dances a week, I don't mean a big function, I mean works dances or what have you, but this one really is to celebrate the Silver Jubilee year of King George. And this was about 1935, as I remember. And I wasn't really old enough to go dancing then, but we were always in town as kids. And we used to go up at them going in. And then again, you see, not many cars, plenty of tram cars. But then again, you knew where the tram was going. In fact, I've seen trams on a busy Saturday afternoon just down here outside Boots and round Cole's Corner. There'd be that many people in the streets, actually on the roadway, that the trams had parted them like a bow wave, gently nudging them, sometimes not so bloody gently, to one side. And nobody, you know, took it as a matter of course. Nobody got nasty or anything like that. I mean, if you got a nudge from a 10-ton tram, like, it soon shifted you. But as I say, you know, it weren't going to swerve or overtake or anything like that. And there again, very good service. I think the crook service, like a lot of them, was about every 3 minutes. So in peak period, so I mean, you got a lot of trams. And there again, people on foot. This was the St. James Club. This is the old guy going there. I remember him, he was a poor old boy. He got badly shot up in the Great War, as they call it. And he had two sticks, I can't remember his name now, but he used to go in the St. James Club, and the Stone House, before it was altered, it was it was always a well-known pub, the Stone House, and obviously with the Cuttles all being just about next door, very popular. They got the flags here, the Australian flag, the old Southern Cross, and Canada, Canadian flag, and South Africa, and what have you. Kenyan flag there, and a couple of young ladies there, she's commiserating with her boyfriend and turned up. This bloke here, now these suits, it was a very popular colour called oxblood, and padded shoulders, nipped in waist, and tight round the behind. They used to call them bum freezers, but the way they were modelled, these suits. And you know, you were somebody if you got an oxblood suit. And probably, you know, from a good tailor, it cost as much as £7, a made-to-measure suit, which was a lot of money, £7. And he's looking at his watch, he's got his box of black magic in his hand here. And obviously she's a bit late. And three young ladies here, with the usual Casanovas after them, and always seem to be like this. Two blokes, obviously, he's a sharp one, he's the leader, he's his adjutant, and this one, he just come along to make weight up. But they've got a sight in here, and you never know what might have transpired. I mean, they'd probably be grandfathers and grandmothers now. I mean, the old cabbies here, you know, they knew Sheffield back to front, and they always seem to have plenty of time for the talk. The old boy here, he's got a young lady friend, he's got a whisker off on his white charger, a Tomlinson's taxi or something, to whatever he wants to do. But this street, and I'm glad that they never did what they wanted to do with that building and knock it down and build a modern block, because this, particularly the Cutler's Hall, it's really a magnificent piece of architecture. And I've tried to portray it as I remember it. But the, just the atmosphere of... picture palace. And I don't know when they'd be built, I don't know. A lot of picture houses were built around about 1910 and that sort of thing. And to my mind, they call them palaces, and they look like palaces. I mean, look at this, it's a little Eastern palace, isn't it? It could be in, I don't know, China or anywhere. It's like a Chinese pagoda. And when you went to picture in those days, you know, you felt as though you were going to have a night out. And this is a memory of mine, the old Lanny there. Now, this building, it's still very much as it was. And these are, they put to different use. So this is still a pub. And this butcher's shop's gone now. But it was one of the old names of Sheffield, Wild and Son meat purveyors. And here, the old Lanny, they're queuing up, obviously, to get in there. And it used to be penny, tuppence and threepence. Penny at the front, tuppence a bit further back, and the balcony was just a floor raised up. It wasn't actually a balcony. There were no galleries standing out. And as kids, we used to go there, and Penny, you'd be up at the front line, but still, you could see all you wanted to see. And Chestnut Man, not Chestnut Bloke, there was one always outside there. Get a bag of chestnuts, you know, about a pound of chestnuts for a penny. And going up London Road, a couple of pubs there, there's a barrel and the old Crown tramway, they're all still there. This was Jay's furnishing store then. And there was a police box there. And as kids, we used to say, and parents used to warn, if you watch yourself, you finish up in box. And everybody knew where box was. It was that one at the end of Boston Street. And they've got a miscreant here. I don't know what he's been doing. He's probably been kicking a can in the street, and they've just given him a 4-minute warning, like, and frightened life out of him. And here, the bloke jumping off a tram. Now, that's a lost art. I mean, the trams weren't enclosed then. And you didn't only need to wait till the stop came to either get off it or get on. The only thing, you have to watch what you're doing, because a lot of these streets were cobbled. And if it had been raining or snowing a bit, imagine coming jumping off a tram doing 20 miles an hour and landing on wet cobbles. You finish up in front of the tram. But, you know, it was a night. You had to get hold of the pole. There was a central pole on the steps. One foot on the bottom step and one foot out like that. And sort of pick up as the tram was slowing. You sort of got ready and you made a run off it. But you could tell the ones who weren't used to trams and all that, you know, they'd step off backwards and do a cartwheel or step off foreign. And the old Lansdowne pub here, the tenant's house then, and it was a fairly big pub actually, well, like a lot of them were. And they used to have a turn or two on now and again, but not much, they never did much with a turn. But I have a lot of memories as of the old Lanny. One in particular was the night of the Blitz. And I should have gone to the art school then. I was working at Cooper Brothers as an apprentice silversmith. And I used to go two nights a week, Tuesday and Thursday night. And on the Thursday night, there was a good picture on for the Lansdowne. So my brother and me decided to go there first house. And we got there for 6 o'clock and paid tuppence or whatever it was, because I mean, you had to pay a bit more than the one to kid them. And at 7 o'clock, there was a warning flashed on the screen, raid in progress. But we'd paid tuppence, we weren't gonna go away like, and where's Tulpenneth? So anyway, at 8:30 when we came out, the attendant said, how far you got to go? Well, I said, yeah, Michael Road, Traddon Street. Well, he said, hurry up, he said, they're dropping them. And we walked along here, and it was very, very quiet. It was moonlight, but a haze of smoke over it. And we were just remarking, you know, well, it's not going off here. And all of a sudden, I thought it was a train coming down London Road. But it wasn't, it was a bomb. And it landed somewhere close on. And by the time the explosion had died away, I was in our shelter in Michael Road. My feet had never touched floor. And anyway, as it so happened, all round here was badly bombed. There's a pub down here called the Hermitage, which was badly bombed and set on fire. And next day I remember having a walk there. Well, it was a couple of days afterwards, actually. And in the wreckage was the till. And it had gone into a molten mass of metal, the old brass till. It was just you could just discern that it had been a till. And the art school, where they should have been that night, that was bombed. But fortunately, no one, as far as I know, was either killed or injured. And it subsequently went up to Salter Lane. So I missed that. And one or two things I'd made there at night, a little child's... I still got the child's can and the child's bowl, which I made. And I was in the process of making the child's plate, making it by hand and engraving it, finishing it and all that. That was lost forever. And funnily enough, somebody rang me up, actually Peter Machin rang me up about the Leadmill Festival, and he said there'd be one or two craftsmen there. Now this is this week, 1986, September, and he said there'd be one or two there, and he said, Norman Marsh, an engraver. He said, do you know him? Well, I said, I do. I said, man, yes, I've not seen him for a bit. I said, last time I saw him, I said, would be December the 10th, 1940. And he gave a little bit of a gulp. He says, that's quite a, well, I said, it is, it's about 46 years, isn't it? Well, he said, I can't remember it, December the 10th. Well, I said, that was the last night I was at the art school, which was a Tuesday. And on the Thursday, when I should have gone, I said, that was a blitz on the 12th, one of the big blitzes. Well, that's why I remember him. And funnily enough, today, as we're doing this, I hope to see him in a couple of hours. Norman Marsh, the first time for 46 years.
From the Blitz?
Yeah. That was December the 10th when I last saw him. So it's a little, well, more than a little bit of affection, the old Lanny, because... and then, during the war, Marks and Spencer's in town were bombed. And this had closed down as a picture palace, and Marks and Spencer's had it as a departmental store. And it was rather funny because you went in this as an entrance, as a store entrance, and where you used to go into the back of the stalls was a store. But there's quite a slope on the floor. As I say, there was no balcony as such, it was just a big slope on the floor. And they couldn't build a floor up, so they put the stalls in. And some of the old dears, when they got to the top here, they got a fair old run down there. And used to play all of that, climbing up this slope again, laden with the purchases, to come out. So, I mean, it had a sloping floor. And, of course, since then, it's had rather a checkered career. It's been the Mecca and Locarno, Tiffany's and what have you. But it's still, to me, and it always will be, and to my generation, the old Lanny. Obviously from these other pictures, but then again, you've got a town like Sheffield, it's unique, well it is to me anyway, that you can be in the middle of town in a busy city street, even now, and within minutes, and I do it on foot, so I mean in a car, and it is literally minutes that you can be in really remote country. And what a selection of country. You've got little country lanes like this, which is David Lane, Westcar Cottages in the bottom here. They were built about, I don't know, 1640s, 1660s they would be built, those. And then up on the top, you're going over to the high moorland. And even at this distance, from there, Ringilaw, that's Ringilaw on the skyline with the round house just peeping up there. It's actually just 5 miles to the centre of Sheffield. But two or even more of those miles are country. So, as I say, in Sheffield, we should be really thankful that we do live in Sheffield, apart from some of its so-called fault. But this view down here...
Where is this, George?
It's
David Lane in the Mayfield Valley, that this area going outwards there is known as the Mayfield Valley. And it's bounded on three sides by, well, that you wouldn't call them hills, but actually Ringinlow is round about the 1,000 feet mark, so you're pretty high. And going along this skyline, that there's Ringinlow, and you go along here to an old house on the corner of the lane called the Buck Trap. In its day, it was an old pub, which a lot of these places, they were there. They called them pubs, well, really, they were farms, and just to brew a bit of beer, and then they got beer delivered. It was just to satisfy the locals there. But bear in mind, in those days of probably 100, 200 years ago, there were more people living in this area than there are now. But for one thing, there were one or two more farms and cottages, and a lot of people in those days had big families. 8 and 10 kids was quite common, and all the fields were worked, you know, they were either cropped or cattle on them. Well, today most of them are just for horses, horse grazing. But it's always been a fascinating little place for me, they say. Going down David Lane, past the West Car cottages, this is the old Mayfield Board School here, and right next to it is a little chapel, little Wesleyan chapel in the valley. Then going up the lane again, Peter Wood here, Peter Wood Farm, up again the lane, up the lane again, up to Greenhouse Farm, Bassett Cottages. All these farms are still pretty much as they were. And there's the Old Mayor Farm and New Mayor Farm, called after Mayfields, I would think. What connotation that had, I don't know, me. And it is even today like that. And this painting, actually, it was done from a memory of this last February when we had a lot of snow. And I did what I could outside, and then, of course, had to complete the painting indoors. And that one, we'll go along a bit. There again, in the Mayfields Valley, and this little group of cottages, car cottages and car houses, the lane coming down here again, and just over the crest of this hill here is a, well, I call this a modern housing estate, but it was built in the late 20s and 30s. But you immediately leave that and come down Quiet Lane along Mayfields Road up into Mayfields Valley. And as you can imagine, it looks quite remote. That was the old blacksmith shop in the corner. He went up here, and a lot of the farmers and whatnot used to bring the horses and farm implements and all that to the blacksmith. No longer uses it, the smithy, obviously. And this little row of cottages, car cottages, one of those was a pub in the, 150 years ago or something like that. And some of the farmers, they like to drop a sauce, and one of them reputedly spent and gambled the family fortune away in this place. And there again, it was on a winter's day of this year. There's one good thing about it, when you haven't got a car, you can stand in the middle of the road drawing, and you know you're not going to be woofed down by the Mercedes or something like that. And like this chap, he's come along there with a horse and cart. He'd been to town, he may have had a couple of drinks at the rising sun at Nelly Green, but I don't know how he's going to go on when he hits this drift here. But having said that, they had probably less trouble then than a modern car, because the old horse would get through, and the cart wheels were so big that to get over boulders and ruts and whatnot, that a 3 or 4 foot snowdrift wouldn't bother him too much.
Why did you prefer painting, George? Have you got a preference on subject matter?
No, you know, I paint just as I feel. That's why there's a mixture of town, in the middle of town, industrial scenes, indoor scenes in pubs, and then again, country scenes, country villages. It's just the way
And as I walk round, I can enjoy a walk round in town, and then again, I like to get out in the country.
As a lad, were you a big walker? And
well, I don't know. I've never been a distance walker. I mean, the thing of it is that I was brought up in the days when not many people had cars, and I never really wanted a car anyway. I mean, they get in the blinking way, don't they? I mean, one thing about not having a car, you see, you can walk where you like, and you're not impeded by the weather, you're not held up by the weather. I mean, fog and snow doesn't stop you. And especially in places like this, where, you know, I've been up there, to say it's only 3 or 4 miles from Sheffield, cars have been blocked up. I've seen cars buried under snowdrifts on this road. So, I mean, it's a big asset, really. If I had had a car, I would never have been the painter, whatever standard I am, that I am today. Because for one thing, I'll probably see more in a mile of walking than somebody would see in 50 miles of motoring. I mean, like Constable said, I mean, he didn't do so bad, did he, Constable? He never had a car, did he? And Rembrandt. I mean, your name, ask anybody in the street to name painters, and they probably name people like that, Constable, or many modern painters. That they never had cars, did they? They didn't do so bad. Mayfield Valley. That school on the first painting we had a look at, that's it, the old Mayfield school there. We've come down all in the wall farm up at the top. And down onto Mayfield Road, some of them call it Mill Lane, but I suppose it's better known as Mayfield Road. And this is the little chapel in the valley, as I call it. It's built in about 1870. And in its day, it had a congregation, a regular sort of Sunday congregation of around about 150 people. Now, unfortunately, it's dwindled today to probably 20 people or something like that, 20 regulars. But inside, it's still a beautiful little chapel with the seating, you know, the old style chapel and the organ, the harmonium, whatever it is, and a little vestry and the kitchen. That's why these chimneys are on. It's just the same on that side. I mean, people came on foot then from the farms, all lying about here, and they probably stayed for a cup of tea after the service. And today it is just like that. There are no houses around it. The field go across here to Workhouse Green cottages, which are subject to another painting that I did. Down in the bottom here, there's just a bit of old Mayfield corn mills and whatnot. Now the riding schools. Up here, the road climbs up again, eventually up to Ringinglow. And I always remember scenes like this, even in daytime, you know, when you get a dark sky and heavy snow. Didn't put them off going to chapel. I mean, it does today. I mean, they look out, listen to the weather forecast, and think, oh, crikey, get the telly on and cup of tea and biscuits and whatnot. But then, I mean, it didn't bother them. They went out in it and they plodded through it, and I think they were better for it in a lot of ways. And this couple here, they probably walked a couple of miles and they got a couple of mile walk back, but I didn't bother them. And a far bigger congregation than they get today. So I think there's a moral in it somewhere, but I don't know what it is.
Gonna take a sentimental journey. Gonna say.
Reservation. beautifully painted by some old Victorian sign writer, I would think. And it says, "Blessed is the man that feareth the Lord." And I think probably there's a lot of food for thought in that today. I mean, these people who, you know, really started off this chapel, he had a hard life, a lot harder than people have today, in spite of everybody grumbling. These people had a really hard, tough life, but they didn't grumble as much. And I think that was the creed that they lived by. To anybody today to live up to some of the old, well, I don't know, character building mottos, if you call it. Easily reached from Sheffield, it's the village of Yulgreave. Well, I suppose that most people know Yulgreave for its magnificent church, a really terrific big stone square church that dominates the high street, or main street rather, which is at the other end of Lisfield. But I had a walk around Yulgreave a week or two back, and I've recollections there again of it's probably, I don't know, last time I was in Yulgreave prior to this last, it was might be 30 years ago. But I remember going there before the war. And like a lot of these villages, so quiet and peaceful. Even today, I suppose, they're quiet. But in those, in fact, this picture, I think I'll call it the morning rush hour. And you can see there's a lot of frantic activity in this painting. I mean, this bloke here holding the cartwheel up, they look as though they're set for a good couple of hours. And couple of ladies of the village up there, they're all right, they're in a nice sunny sheltered spot. And the old boy coming for his morning pint, been round about, for opening time. And landlord, he's waiting for him. Landlords look like landlords then. I mean, they got a corporation and a gold Albert to match. And they looked as though they sampled their own brew. Which, nothing wrong with that. And I say, this little street scene, it hasn't altered much again, is it? Still a little school there, some farm buildings, the old farmyard inn, another Methodist chapel here. There seem to be a lot of chapels, and there's a big church in Yulgreave. That was, it still is, I think, I don't know what they call them now, it was the old primitive Methodist chapel. This is the Methodist again. Now, and the kids there playing at, we call it Mabs, marbles. And, my particular venue for marbles was Clarence Street. And now it's a motorway. I often think when I'm trying to get across it, at risk of life and limb, climbing over railings when they should be going down underpasses. That we used to play, that was our football pitch, cricket pitch, well not so much cricket, but it was cobble, it was a bit hazardous for bowling. But we played at football and marbles in Clarence Street, and any sort of a gutter that do for kids, well it did for us anyway. In fact, we used to hook out the pitch in between the cobbles to make runnels for our own game of marbles. A lot play, knocking them out of a ring, I don't know what they call it, it was more of a country game. This ring of marbles, we used to play in the cobbles in town. And the gas lamps there, I know these sodium lamps, they're probably more efficient and to give a better light, but the old gas lamp, when it wasn't lit, it looked decorative. I mean, you get these tall concrete spindly ones now, and they never look nice. Even when they lit up, they don't look right, but the old gas lamp, I mean, it was a meeting place. We had a particular gas lamp, and you could chin up and get a light for a fag. You know, a fag you'd roll out of time. Go a fair distance. Well, you have a bit of fun with a stick and a good set of railings, rattling them. I mean, that's a pleasure that's gone. And look at him standing there in the middle of the street. You could always be in the street, have the street at a playground. I mean, I know they were in Sheffield, they set up one or two bits of playgrounds for kids with swings on and roundabouts. They some of the steel barons put them up in the highly popular district, but, well, we always preferred to play in the street. I know, well, kids have lost that pleasure now. And this little country scene is different from a town scene or the sort of more remote valley scenes. The activity had always remained in my mind, these little sunny village streets. The sun's still there, the street's still there, but there's a lot more traffic and what have you. But and I still say, I think it's not a bad title for this, it's The Morning Rush Hour, You'll Grieve. Street as it used to be. Now it's altered rather drastically, this bit, but there again, having said that, the Lyceum Theatre's still there. This is the now where the Crucible Theatre is, but up to, well, probably 20 years ago, and certainly in the period when this painting takes place in the 1930s, it's got to be, because the Theatre Royal was burned down about 1935 or so, 36. But these buildings were pretty much the same from the day they were built, probably 150 years ago, something like that. This was a big building which went on to Norfolk Street. Then two or three small shops. There was Jackson's Oyster Bar. You could go in there, get a plate of oysters, a wedge of lemon, and some nice thin new brown bread and butter. Four oysters would be probably about half a crown. Always spotlessly clean, scrupulously clean, with nice tables, and they'd open the oysters for you. And when you'd had a couple of pints in the old Adelphi, Tommy Bolton's, as it was always known, he was a landlord. Everybody knew it as Tommy Bolton's, not so much the Adelphi. Stone's house, and inside there were hundreds of signed photographs by all the stars, some of them weren't stars, who had appeared at the Lyceum and the Theatre Royal over a very long period. All the top names, because, well, again, in those days, even the pros didn't have cars, they travelled by train to these places, and they'd nip across either before the show or when the act was finished, or during the interval, have a couple of drinks, and that's probably how he amassed his collection of photographs. And this is Sycamore Street, just down here, no longer with us, and it went down eventually to Flat Street, where the GPO is. Halfway down it, on the right-hand side, was a pub called the Shakespeare. And there was a portrait of Shakespeare in there, reputed to be painted from life. I don't know how true that was. And opposite was a blacksmith shop. I think they called the blacksmith Yates. And he'd be hammering away, as I say, just round the corner from where the Crucible now is. And going along then on Arundel Street, which led to the old College of Art, there was another pub there, the Theatre Tavern, but this was Gallimore's Spoon and Fork Factory, one of the old Sheffield names again. And behind that, on Pond Street, where the modern Polytech now is, was Rawson's Brewery, a very big brewery, and one of the first in Sheffield. Breweries in Sheffield. Going off on another tack, in its day, per head of population, Sheffield had more pubs per head than any other town in England. It had as many breweries as Burton-on-Trent, a little known and probably a useless fact, but still, it's all part of the history, isn't it? And Mays, they made basketware, furniture, baskets, which there were a lot of uses for baskets in the old days, which have all gone now. They've been superseded by plastic or modern man-made materials. I wonder what some of those things would be worth today. One of the things I remember pushing as a kid was a great big square wooden basket on wheels, woven out of very thick wicker with a lid on, and carting silverware about, and it had three wheels on it, one at the front and one at each side, and a pair of handles. And the basket would probably be, I don't know, 4 or 5 foot long and a couple of feet, 3 feet wide and 3 feet deep with a big lid on. Be a collector's item now. And there again, the old Lyceum, it's still there, and sadly it's been in a state of neglect for some years, but hopefully there's a move afoot now, and hopefully that we might see it again in its former glory, because it really was a magnificent theatre inside, a very big stage, and I don't know how many it would seat, but I would imagine somewhere around the 3,000 mark. And it had the feel of a theatre there. There's the old red plush seats, thick carpeting, golden cherubs and seraphims and shells and everything.
How does Crucible rate, George?
Well, the Crucible is a modern theatre, and I suppose people who never experienced or not had much experience of an old-time theatre enjoy it, and it is a different type of theatre. But the Lyceum could put these big extravaganzas on, the big musical show, they could put opera on, and anything like that where it needed a lot of scenery, the old Lyceum could do it, where the Crucible seems to be limited in that respect. But I would think that really one could complement the other. I mean, after all, it's just a few yards away. I mean, even a linking between them, a bridge or some sort of tie-up between the two, and to make it an enjoyable night out. I don't like this word complex. It's a bit too complex for me. I mean, it doesn't sound like entertainment to me to call these things a complex. But the Lyceum, you know, it was built, I don't know, probably 100 years ago, but it still looks better to me than a lot of the modern buildings which have been put up. And I can imagine, as I say, brought back to its former glory, or even better with present day equipment, that it could be a really magnificent theatre. And across the road was the old Theatre Royal, which was burnt down, as I say, 1935 or something like that, 1773. I mean, we're going back a bit then. I think we're still in America then. But it was refurbished over the years. And in its day there again, I mean, it would seat probably 3,000 people. And my recollections of it, and my father taking me there, he always liked the theatre, he was a Liverpudlian, and he'd been brought up on the old Argyle Birkenhead and theatre in its heydays in the pre-1914 theatre. But he always went to the theatre in Sheffield. He never went much to the Lyceum, but then the variety theatres like the Theatre Royal and the Empire in Charles Street, he took me there from, well, as early, far back as I can remember as a child. And we usually went in the upper circle, but when I got old enough, I used to go to in the gallery on my own in the Lyceum. But I remember when the Theatre Royal was burnt down, my father was very upset about it, because he was a regular there every week at least. And I remember these steps here, and at the bottom was a woman selling oranges. And, well, one of my recollections, and funnily enough, I was speaking to somebody of my age, And he said the same. He said, you know, the thing I remember about the old theatres, he says, was the smell of oranges. And I should think every other person would be sucking half an orange or peeling an orange. And imagine the smell of that, what with cigarette and tobacco smoke and no deodorants in those days, and gas lighting. They had gas jets, actually, I remember, in the Theatre Royal, open gas jets. So, I mean, you got a good atmosphere. They were all obviously designed by different architects and built by various builders who specialised in theatre building. Very ornate, a lot of mahogany, red plush, that the bars were mahogany, and I mean real mahogany, not veneer or ply or formica or anything like that. And brass, a profusion of brass and red plush. And before the performance, and sometimes during the interval, they'd come round squirting some sort of scent out of sprays. Which, if you were near enough, you got a bit of a bath as well as a splashdown of this scent. So having a disinfectant scented up a bit. But, the thing of it was that there wasn't television then, you see, and a night out at the pictures or the theatre was a night out. You'd walk into town and or get a tram into town for a penny and tuppence or something like that. Go and have a couple of drinks, and this picture's called Early Doors, and the reason for that is that the actual performance first out started off by 6. You could go in, pay a couple of 2 extra, an hour sometimes before the actual opening of the theatre, before the performance started rather, and to get a good seat. And a lot of people used to do that, so they get their early doors going with an orange and a bag of toffees or something like that. And part of the entertainment would be sitting there at a good vantage point, not too near the front, so they could see people coming in. And they'd be picking spots off them all. And sometimes it was as much an entertainment to them that hour before the show started. And then, again, during the interval, they find somebody else, where she got that fur coat from, sort of thing. She ain't got it last week. And part of it, it was a night out, and in the interval, you go up there again, you go and have a drink. Nobody was bothered about breathalyzers then, you ain't got cars. So they'd come out and have a couple more. That's providing they got enough to have a couple of drinks. But usually, they'd save up for at least one night a week out either at the theatre and the pictures. And sadly now the old Theatre Royal, as I say, it's a car park. These buildings have gone, the Crucible's still here, and I wish that we could get the Lyceum back. And the buskers, there are all sorts of turns. In fact, some of the turns outside were as good, if not better, than the ones inside, and it was free. I mean, all you had to do was chuck a penny in the cap or not even bother with that. And these 3 chaps here, like a lot of them, they were First World War veterans, come back to a land fit for heroes to live in, and after a year or two they were out of work, and their only clothes, apart possibly from the wedding suit, were the old army greatcoat, or what was left of the uniform, a tunic. And that's what these chaps are here, and they're doing it to support the family, because there's not much else coming in. But there again, they give a good performance, the best of their ability anyway. And it passed a nice little hour on, well, not being, you won't be queuing up for an hour, but a good few minutes on. And this little lass and the brother here, and little baby in the pram, well, they probably lived just round the corner, which in the centre of town in those days, I mean, there was still a lot of houses there, and people had never walked round at night to pass the time on there. And she'd been sent out, or she'd come out with the pram and a little lad, and just looking on at the buskers playing, and
somebody might chuck them half orange or something like that before they went in. I'll come out and not having eaten an orange, you might get a few toffees and whatnot. And the three ladies here, well, you can see they've, there's going to be many a battle fought under that flag. And they've just come out of the Adelphi, and they'd probably be going around the corner to Hayes, just to have a little more light refreshment. Favourite tipple of the ladies of that era were Baby Guinness. Small bottles of Guinness, about a third of a pint Guinness, and very popular. They always said, oh, the best Guinness is Baby Guinness. But they obviously have started off in good shape, and they're going around the corner. They might be going to, might finish up at the theatre aisle. Doubtful if they'd be going to the Lyceum. It looks a bit heavy sometimes, the entertainment there, but it catered for a different section of the public, really, the Lyceum. But yeah, you had the choice of Best of Both Worlds, that you could get the variety at the Lyceum, at the Theatre Royal, and across at the Lyceum, you would get the plays or the big musicals, opera, ballet even, which were very, very well down the bill, as they say. Today, are television stars. And they had the grounding, and I think all of them will say that, and speak with gratitude of the days that they spent on the boards in these theatres. And it's apprenticeship that a lot of the present day ones have never had. I suppose they do all right, but the older ones always speak with affection about the live theatre, and I'm pleased to see that a lot of these towns like Leeds and Bradford have refurbished the theatres, and I hope that we can do the same in Sheffield for this. Now, people are running about, he's got the green and he's hoping to sell the last few greenings, this chap running up the road. Now, another little item there, we used to call it the Bookmakers Club, the Victoria Club. And it seemed to be most of its members were bookmakers. And there's one here coming out. People, you could virtually tell who they were those days. You could usually spot somebody as a bookie, a publican, a doctor, or something like that. I mean, this is before the days of the universal uniform of jeans and a t-shirt. I mean, people dressed for what they were. He's got his oxblood suit on, then, taking his young lady, and might be going for a plate of oysters, or buy her some spice at little sweet shop there. All these places were handy. I mean, you could go out to, you know, at night, now where can you get a packet of fags there from a shop in the centre of town, or a plate of oysters? Results of memories of places and people of the 30s, and what I do, I go out and sketch what's left of them. Not a deal left now, as you can imagine. I mean, the Blitz didn't do all that much damage. It knocked a few buildings down, but not nearly as many as been knocked down in the time since. And this sketch here, which I did only the other day, it's the back of Pickering's, we used to call it, cardboard box factory. The back of it came onto Myrtle Road, where I was born and lived till I got married. And there again, it was our playground. The back of it, even today, there's a little inspection grate. And we used to chalk the middle three bars of this inspection grate for cricket stumps. And these were paving stones here. Houses right up to it, and houses in the backyard there. Houses along this side. The actual width of the road is about 5 yards. And a good camber on the road. So you could send an in-swinger in off the camber of the road. The only thing you had to be careful about was knocking somebody's window in, which did happen. But on that, it was ideal, because after Pickering's had finished work, that the place was shut up, the factory was closed up, you see. And we were in this, and there's been many or thought out cricket mats there. Night after night in summer we played there. If we didn't go up to Aincliffe, that's where we played cricket. And I must do a painting of this because there's some move afoot now to turn it, well, part of it is a car park now, where all the little houses were, where I was born, Michael Road, Humble Road, Nurse Road and Bridgefield Road. You can still just see the outlines of the little streets, and it always amazes me how many houses were actually in that little area. Houses, backyards, outside lavatories, little factories, stablings, and then again, well, it's like the Sahara Desert now. It's like Stalingrad on a Sunday afternoon, where I spent my childhood days, as it is. But still, anyway, enough of this. It's all like this talking and rabbiting on, but I've got to get a bit of painting done, so I'll just carry on with this Nellathorpe place. This is an area of Sheffield which was very, very thickly populated around the St. Philip's and Meadow Street area, and the post office here is Port Mahone, I think the pronunciation of it is, post office, and the area was known as Port Mahone. And I don't know what connection it has with the island of Minorca. I mean, that's their main port, isn't it? Port Mahone. And Nelson had his big naval base there 200 or 300 years ago. So why a district like this in the very heart of Sheffield was known as Port Mahone, I don't know. But it's always intrigued me, right up to, probably less than 20 years ago, about the variety of little shops. You got the post office here, you got Savvy's the Butchers, a couple of very small shops. In fact, one of them, a pal of mine, used to be Saturday Lad there, and the address was number 15 and a half. Nellathorpe Place, a strange number, not 15 here, or anything like that. It was 15 and a half. And yet it was a full-sized, only a small shop. But every shop had a character of its own. There were no supermarkets, and there were the big stores, but not the impersonal supermarkets which we've got today. And people could go shopping, and they'd have all the time in the world to go to shop. And they had big families and all that. But just the same, shopping then, I would imagine, even for the woman, it was a pleasure. They certainly looked happy about it. They weren't flying about with Alice looks on and calculating in the hands like they do today. And I always seemed to have this feeling that if I ever did paint, I'd remember these little shops. Before I left school at 13, I was Saturday Lad, as they call them, at a butcher's shop in Clarence Street, Saturday morning, taking meat out for about 4 or 5 hours, from 8 o'clock till 1 o'clock or something like that. Got one in a tanner for that, which quite a bit of money then, and very often there'd be some sausage sewn in, and perhaps a bit of stewing meat or something like that that wouldn't keep very long. And I think that's probably how I got to know a lot of these areas. And so with being a Saturday Lad, apart from the time I spent roaming round as a kid, more so than, well, the present day child or youth hasn't had the opportunities which we had. Well, for one thing, that the areas aren't there now, and the situations which enable you to get a Saturday morning job, they don't have them now. I mean, as far as I know, nobody has a lad to deliver meat or groceries or anything like that, which were very common. You could always get a job as a Saturday Lad. The only thing is, it meant humping about half a hundred weight of meat about in a big basket.
Except along the tanner. But there again, I mean, what my first week's wage when I started work at 14 was 9 shillings a week, 45p for a 48-hour week. And I thought I was made. I thought, well, all this money. Well, I gave most of it to my mother, but it still seemed to me a lot of money. And in spite of what people say, it didn't go as far as money does today. Some things were...